Namaste, angels. I'm here to do a daily for October 1st. And yes, October 1st is a Saturday, so normally I would not do a daily. Why am I doing one? Well, because it's one of the days for which Spirit had told me to do a video. And I had done a video. It's the one that I spoke of in the October 8th video where I said, I'm not sure if I'm going to post it because I was like stammering and asking Archangel Michael, what the hell is going on with my voice? Why can't I speak? Since then, I accidentally deleted it, and I was unfazed by deleting it. I was like, oops, oh well, guess I wasn't meant to post it. But soon after, I started getting inbox messages from females all over the world, actually, because one was in Norway, saying like they can't take it anymore, they're feeling dark energy from the masculine, what can they do, how can they protect themselves? They're fed up, they can't do this anymore, that sort of thing. And I was saying, right away I felt, he's a Scorpio, isn't he? It's because of Lilith and Scorpio. What is Lilith and Scorpio? I spoke about this, I believe April or May, at great length. We talked about Lilith and how she can affect you if she's in your chart with the black moon. Well, the black moon is rising for some of us on Friday, for others on Saturday. And for the rest, not until October 30th, because what is a black moon? It's when a new moon, the rare occurrence when you get a new moon twice in 1 month. So that's not going to actually happen for everybody until October 30th. It depends what hemisphere you're in. So some of us will get it now, and some of us will get it for Halloween. In any case, when you get it, or this on this occasion when we get it, some of us will be affected by Lilith in Scorpio. So I'm going to do a daily, but I've also asked Spirit to please show me anything that we need to see for those people who will be affected, who may be affected, or for all of us, how we might be affected, those of us that are sensitive to the moon, particularly by Lilith in Scorpio. Because again, how it has affected some is that the masculine, who happens to be a Scorpio, is coming across to them very aggressive, dark. One just moved away. Now, some of you may know, my twin is a Scorpio also. I have not spoken to him, and I'm glad. Like, I knew about Lilith and Scorpio, so I'm certainly not going to be approaching him. But what it can do to a man with it in his chart is make him extremely vulnerable, particularly to females within their chart. So if you were watching that time that I did the Venus, I read a Venus card. I read the story of Venus and her husband, the quote unquote lame god of the forge, and how, you know, she was bored by him. So he had to basically sit around while she had sex with other men. But their marriage persevered because they were like opposite, right? Day and night, and opposite attract and all that kind of stuff. He was lame. She was hot in the pants. So that's basically what this Lilith in Scorpio is. A lot of sexual energy right now, but it can go super, super negative and in the wrong direction, depending on first whether it's in your chart, and if so, how strongly. All right, so I'm going to do a daily, but I'm going to ask also for anything that we need to see about that, any forewarning that is necessary. And hopefully whatever we need to know will come through. I'm also going to talk to you a little bit about the black moon. Unfortunately, I don't have what I previously had included. I don't have that anymore. Also, during that reading, I had talked about my God box, or how I was going to make one, basically putting in things that I wanted to change about myself, that I wanted new, into a box. You know, writing little notes to myself. And then I pulled out one of my decks of cards, and they happened to have a card in there about God box that I stopped and opened on and then dealt into the spread. And I had no idea. I mean, like, it wasn't, you know, obviously that wasn't planned. So I still think that's something that anybody who's into it should do. Because Spirit sort of co-signed my plans that day. Okay, so I'll go straight to on this day. This is, oh, nope, I have the 29th open. I'm sorry. Well, maybe I'm supposed to read some of this, but did I? No, I will have gone over the 29th already. So 1 second, bear with me, I apologize. Saturday, October 1st is what I want to do. Historical events. In the year 331 BC, Alexander the Great defeats Darius III of Persia in the Battle of Gaugamela. 1688, Prince Willem III of Orange accepts invitation to take up the British crown. 1814, the opening of Congress in Vienna redrew Europe's political map after the defeat of Napoleon Bonaparte. 1867 or 13, Das Kapital by Karl Marx is published. 1908, Henry Ford introduces the Model T car. It was $825 to buy. The year 1988, Mikhail Gorbachev, becomes chairman of the Presidium, P-R-E-S-I-D-I-U-M, of the Supreme Soviet, effectively the head of state of the Soviet Union. Did you know National Geographic magazine publishes for the first time on this date, October 1st, in the year 1888? Famous birthdays, Bonnie Parker. She was born in 1910. She died in 1934. And I had continued to have thoughts about Bonnie Parker, Bonnie and Clyde, and I don't know why. But I had a lot of synchronicities with that story. It just continues to get interesting. Jimmy Carter, it's also his birthday. He will be 91 years old. Richard Harris was born in 1930. He died in 2002. Julie Andrews, whose birthday is on this day, will be 81 years old. And Mark McGuire will be 53 years old. Famous weddings. In 1791, Prince Willem Frederick, later the King of the Netherlands, marries his cousin, Princess Frederica Louise Wilhelmina of Prussia. In 1884, politician William Jennings Bryan, 24, weds Mary sweetheart Elizabeth Byard. 1913, writer and poet Vita Sackville West, 21, marries diplomat Harold Nicholson, 26. 1949, television host and comedian Johnny Carson, 23, weds Joan Morrill Walcott, 23, at the North Platte Episcopalian Church. And 1984, actress Sigourney Weaver, 34, weds filmmaker Jim Simpson, 28. Famous deaths. Louis Leakey, who was born in 1903, he died in 1972. And E.B. White was born in 1899, he died in 1985. I told you guys my Sigourney Weaver story with the eighth, right? I believe. Okay, so since there were only two deaths, let me tell you about these. Louis Leakey is British, an archaeologist. He's famous for his work on establishing human evolutionary development in Africa, particularly through his discoveries in the Olduvai Gorge, G-O-R-G-E. He was born on August 7th in the year 1903. He's a Leo from Kabete, Kenya, K-A-B-E-T-E. He died on October 1st in the year 1972 at the age of 69. Like I always say, this is year 69. He died of a heart attack. And for some reason, I hear Archangel Raphael behind me with his sirens. Maybe just because today is Archangel Day. Specifically Michael, but some people just say Archangel's Day, or Archangels Raphael, Michael, and Uriel I've also seen. In any case, E.B. White, born in 1899, is an American writer. Why is he famous? Well, he wrote Charlotte's Web and also Elements of Style. He was born on July 11th in the year 1899. So 7/11 or 18 or 9 in the year 999. He's a Cancer from Mount Vernon, New York, USA. He died on October 1st in the year 1986, at age 86, of Alzheimer's. Interesting. And we did Bonnie Parker the other day, but I guess maybe if anybody missed it, she's an American outlaw, the female half of Bonnie and Clyde, born on October 1st in the year 1910-11. So she was born on 11-11 under the sign Libra in Rowena, Texas, USA. She died on May 23rd in the year 1934 at the age of 23. She died on the 23rd at 23 of gunshot wounds. Jimmy Carter is going to be 91 on this date. He's a U.S. president, the 39th to be exact, a Democrat from Georgia. He had been the governor there first. His presidential term was from January 20th, 1977 through January 20th, 1981. He is preceded by Gerald Ford. He is succeeded by Ronald Reagan. Why is he famous? Well, he was the 39th president of the United States. He was also awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in the year 2002. During his term as president, he created two new cabinet-level departments, the Department of Energy and the Department of Education. He established a national energy policy that included conservation, price control, and new technology. The end of his presidential tenure was marked by the 1979 through 1981 Iran hostage crisis. He was born on October 1st in the year 1924. He will be 91 years old on this day, God willing. He's a Libra from Plains, Georgia, USA. Richard Harris is an Irish actor and singer, best known for his role as Frank Machin in The Sporting Life and as King Arthur in the 1967 film Camelot. He was born on October 1st in the year 1930 under the sign of Libra from Limerick, Ireland. He died on October 25th in the year 2002 at the age of 72, 9 of Hodgkin's disease. Julie Andrews will be 81 years old or 9 on this date. She's a British actress and singer, is eternally best known for her portrayals of Mary Poppins, showing remarkable forbearance in the face of Dick Van Dyke's Cockney accent, and Maria in The Sound of Music. She is also an author of children's books. Born on October 1st in the year 1935, she will be 81 on this date, a Libra from Walton-on-Thames, Surrey, England. And lastly, Mark McGwire will be 53 years old. He's an American first baseman, nicknamed Big Mac. He played first base for the Oakland Athletes and the St. Louis Cardinals between 1986 and 2001. He averaged a home run once every 10.61 at-bats, the best at-bats per home run ratio in baseball history, and achieved national fame in 1998 in his pursuit of the Roger Maris single-season home run record. He is born on October 1st in the year 1963. He will be 53 years old. He's a Libra from Pomona, California, USA. Okay. So, I'm beginning with the Six of Water. Memories from your history or childhood. Issues regarding children, possibly. And romanticizing the past. And what do I think about but my daughter, who's a Scorpio, who, you know, could have some of this Lilith. Now, I wouldn't say a lot because we've read about what happens to when you have it heavy in your chart, but some she could have. Opposite that is the Knight of Fire, passionate, adventurous, self-assured, and restless, a sudden event that needs immediate attention. Time is of the essence. Think things through carefully. So I was mentioning that just in case I wasn't clear, because this card not only is a soulmate card and a past life relationship card, but can be, again, issues regarding children. So since it's a water or cups card, I immediately thought about my child who is a water sign, a Scorpio herself. Okay. Just in case that applies to anybody else and your child is acting a little bit, you know, unlike they normally would. It could be the moon itself. and or moon in Scorpio, Lilith in Scorpio rather, and black moon in Scorpio. Okay. Now open to the Eight of Water, a desire to move on, the search for something more meaningful, spiritual, and emotional growth. The Knight of Fire is back. And now I'm opening to the Chariot, Archangel Metatron, an important achievement, self-discipline and willpower, public recognition. And the Knight of Fire is back yet again. Ah, how lovely is this? Landing on the Sun, Archangel Uriel. Happy feast day, Archangel Uriel. Nice to see you. And she says that to us, happy outcome, brilliant new ideas that lead to success. Have confidence in yourself. I have to do a couple of personal readings too. I probably won't do those until tomorrow. The bottom of the deck is the Two of Air, being unable or unwilling to make a decision, a stalemate, pretending there is no problem. So some of us may have a decision to make, perhaps between two people. That's the first thing I always think of when I see the Two of Air. Okay, let me tell you a little bit about the Black Moon. I'm so sorry that I can't find that what I had used, what I had gone over the first time, because it was really informative. In any case, October 1st is the 274th day of the year, 11-11, in the Gregorian calendar. There are 91 days remaining, one until the end of the year. It's a Saturday, the sign of Libra. There are events and holidays and observances on this date all over the world, including International Day for Old Persons and more. Okay, Lilith in the signs of the zodiac. And this is just a website. I pulled up a random one again because I could not find the one that I had, where I had done a little bit more research the other day. This one is called Astro. EsotericPro.com, AstroEsoterikPro.com. So this is not my website, and that's whose it is. Okay, Lilith in the signs of the zodiac. The position of the Black Moon in a birth chart shows the dark side of one's personality, a side that exists in every person, even if each one manifests it with their own nuances. This is the side of a personality that will inevitably lead the person to her downfall if she feeds it and indulges it. It contains the temptations lurking at a deep level in our subconscious, as well as our attraction for reprehensible actions on a moral as well as on an ethical level, all of which that can eventually lead to the destruction of our personality. So it sounds pretty crappy. Lilith is not capable of bringing us happiness, as she is not able to trigger real life events as the real planets do. Her impact is exerted on the psyche, on our passions, and on the desires, the deepest of our desires. The black moon generates an astral vortex that arouses emotions and strong desires, blurring awareness and preventing us from controlling or regulating its influence. So those who have it in their chart strongly, and like I said, some men have been known to be similar to how it was described. They were affected by the goddess Venus. They would just sort of fall prey to her. Like that one in the one card that I have, where the boyfriend had like fallen prey to her and ran off with her and then decided he wanted his woman back, came back and the woman died, right? Because he was fooling with Lilith, basically, who was means you no good. Okay. The position of Lilith in our horoscope. Did I read this last one? The black moon generates an astral vortex that arouses emotions and strong desires, blurring awareness and preventing us from controlling or regulating its influence. I think I had, but okay, we need to hear that again. The position of Lilith in our horoscope also shows what type of people amongst those we meet on our path will play a provocative role in our lives or even be our enemies. All these roles are meant to help us in our evolution, which is why it is much better not to hold grudges against the people who have to play them. You know, we should always forgive, and I've said many times it's better for us. Anyway, it helps us more than it helps the person, you know, whom we actually forgive to do so. They are imposed to them in spite of their own will, and it is better for us to focus on the negative manifestations of Lilith in our own psyche, as well as on its effects on our own behavior, according to her position in our horoscope. If these negative events are understood, and if the necessary efforts are made, no further provocation will frighten us. Lilith is also associated with the worst human sin, suicide, which is probably the extreme consequence of all passions when they are pursued relentlessly. But the choice still belongs to the individual, and Lilith is powerless against the will of a person who sees her for what she is and decides to oppose her. Like any other devil or aspect of the devil, we have to rebuke this, plain and simple. Now, this website actually lists dates along with the different astrological signs where you may be able to find out if it's in your chart on this page. Like, for example, the first one is Lilith in Aries and has a bunch of dates, birth dates that I guess possible ones. And then it says the person feels, if you fall into this category, the person feels that she is a pioneer in everything she does and asserts her personality at the expense of others. She can be aggressive when people defined by her as passive do not wish to follow her generous and unselfish impulses, even though she is in fact making sure not to let anyone get ahead of her, putting her own priorities forward. The person can go as far as to step on the heads of others and crush those who stand in her way. Her behavior is unpredictable, and she believes everything to be allowed to her. So this is somebody who is very much entitled, this Lilith in Aries person. She may have excessive activity, a strong sensual, and show cruelty. I don't know what a strong sensual means. Yeah, that doesn't make much sense, grammatical sense to me, but that's what it says here. A strong sensual and show cruelty, as well as the tendency to be excessively demonstrative. The provocative roles are played by employees and male peers. And then she goes on to the inferior level, the intermediate level, and the superior level. So depending upon how heavy in your chart it is, you will be different. It'll affect you differently. An example of Lilith in Taurus. A frugal person can become stingy, a gourmand turned into a glutton, and a natural desire to earn a living can degenerate into greed. The person is trying to maintain control over everything within her reach and also feels satisfaction when someone is financially dependent of her. She repays her debts with much difficulty and hates her creditors. She shows an excessive attachment to material goods and pleasures, as well as a desire to own everything. She has a passionate character, but a tendency toward inertia and laziness. So that's Lilith in Taurus. Now I'm just going to skip to Lilith in Scorpio to demonstrate what we might be dealing with now. Some of us. The person tries to compel others to satisfy her exacerbated desires by bringing the emotional climate to its breaking point, because the peaceful solution simply never seems to interest her. She has an unconscious tendency to manipulate others just for pleasure, using her strength and power. She has a penchant for thrills, for excess, when judging other people's character, and for making scenes. She shows sensuality in her instincts, an attraction for magic and for the occult, and a weakness for vices. She can act as a cunning manipulator, nasty and terrible. The provocative roles are played by people of artistic or dangerous occupations, as well as by occultists of all kind. So I would guess that probably, for example, Jezebel in the Bible was likely had this Lilith in Scorpio. God saw fit to have her killed because she was a quote-unquote harlot and basically like a, you know, voodoo priestess. You know, she practiced dark magic according to the Bible and was a slut. That's what it says there. It's not me saying it. In any case, if you want to read about the other signs, how they are affected, again, the page is AstroEsotericPro.com, AstroEsotericPro.com. Now, this is from the Telegraph, the newspaper, and I saw it in USA.com and Time and all these different things, but I just clicked on the first one. Black moon set to rise this week in rare lunar event, but what is it? A rare black moon is set to rise on Friday night, Saturday morning. But what exactly is the lunar event, and will we be able to see it? Black moon rising may sound like the title of an apocalyptic sci-fi film, but the astronomical event is unlikely to signal the end of the world, despite concerns of some doomsayers. What is a black moon? From blood moons to strawberry ones and those of a super variety, it can be difficult to keep up with all the different names given to the Earth's natural satellite. The latest causing excitement among stargazers is the so-called black moon. However, there are several definitions about what it actually is. Most experts agree the term black moon refers to the second new moon in a calendar month. It shouldn't be confused with a blue moon, a phenomenon that occurs when there is a second full moon in one calendar month. So the black moon is a new moon and the blue moon is a full moon. Joe Rao, R-A-O, from space.com explains, a second full moon in a single calendar month is sometimes called a blue moon. A black moon is supposedly the flip side of a blue moon, the second new moon in a single calendar month. The last black moon was in March of 2014, and the next one after this is expected in the year 2019. Other black moon definitions. Time and date explains, black moon is not a well-known term in the astronomy world. In recent years, the term has been made more popular by astrologers and followers of the Wiccan religion. It is also defined as the third new moon in a season of four new moons, a calendar month without a new moon, a calendar month without a full moon. And then under this, very interesting, so you might want to go to the Telegraph .co.uk/news about the black moon and check this out. There's a picture here, the full moon seen behind the Hill of the Three Crosses from Reuters. I just find it interesting that I opened this page and here there is three crosses with the full moon behind it. So what exactly is a new moon? A new moon occurs every 29.5 days. The new moon disappears, from the sky when it is between the Earth and the Sun. with its illuminated side facing away from us. Will we be able to see the Black Moon? The Black Moon event will take place in the early hours of Saturday morning at 1:11 a.m. 1:11 for those in the Western Hemisphere. The Black Moon will coincide with Halloween for those in the Eastern Hemisphere. So this is what I was talking about when I first started the video. Unfortunately, you won't actually be able to see it, as the moon will appear invisible. It will just be very dark. So it's going to look like it's not, there is no moon. Don't worry. It's very unlikely the Black Moon will affect your weekend plans, despite doomsayers predicting it could be the end of humanity. End of the world? Question mark. Doomsday believers predicted the apocalypse in July. Here's how the internet reacted. Okay, so that's something else you can check out on the telegraph.co.uk if you are interested. All right. The masculine is the seven of fire. He is in defense mode. Defend your beliefs and decisions. Stand your ground. Choose your battles wisely. So maybe he has to defend himself against a Lilith. And if you are his twin, his divine feminine, maybe you need to fall back and allow him to do that and not take it personal. If he can't talk, needs to be away from you. You know, I don't know what aggressive means, and I don't want to minimize anybody's difficulties in their relationship, but sometimes it's a matter of, like, we need to leave a person alone if it's not a good time for them. And I would say Lilith and Scorpio for many is not going to be a good time. I mean, a bunch of, even if it's not in your chart, so many of us are like super, super sensitive to the moon, and you know, our behaviors change with it. So maybe just fall back. Also this week, God, you know, he sent me those numbers, whispers numbers in my ear, and like I'm directed to look up verses in the Bible and stuff. And one this week basically co-signed a reading that I did where I said, here's the man holding a heart. And I said, I think he just, you know, the universe just wants us to stay in this moment in love and ignore all this stuff that's going on around us. And that Bible verse basically said the same thing. There was also another one that said, this is not the one I was going to talk about, but there was one about men leaving home. And I also mentioned that in a recent reading, that I felt like some of them were going to be, quote unquote, leaving home, like leaving their parents, for example. And I was given that Bible verse about how a man leaves home to join with his wife as one soul. So that was very twin flame-ish. That was definitely meant for us. And the one that I was talking about in this moment just now before I got redirected by myself, was one where it said that hope and faith, basically, like if we have to see everything to believe it, that's not hope and faith. That's just not hope and faith. So if you have to see your feminine, if you have to see your masculine in order to believe that things are going on behind the scenes that are making it possible for you guys to fully reunite in the near future, then that's not faith or unconditional love, you know, basically for the higher beings, you know, for the universe, for God. That's not unconditional love. That's not faith. Okay. And again, that's not my word. That is the word. Surrounding the masculine is the knight of earth, loyal, dedicated, honorable, kind. Time to buckle down and get things done. Honor your commitments. You have a guardian angel. This card shows up in this position quite a bit, actually. And in his subconscious is ego. Well, this is the devil, and it makes sense. I mean, that's basically what Lilith is. You know, she would be considered the devil's wife or the female devil, the world's or the universe's first succubus, Medusa, Nephthys, Lilitu in Egypt. You know, 10 a million different names, but it's the devil, basically. And here it is in the masculine subconscious. A false sense of entrapment, being overly focused on material things and negative or fear-based thoughts. So she could be fooling with him. You know, it might just be a matter of waiting a few days before you make a rush decision. And look what's under here. Under that decision. I mean, yeah, the two of air. The four of fire. Okay, so I think maybe if we just hold off on any rush decisions, any snap decisions about the masculine's behavior or lack thereof, this is still waiting. That love that the reading showed we need to hold on to, and that the Bible passage, I wish I remember the verse off the top of my head, I do not. Many of you saw it and commented, and I was clear to note, you know, to connect it to that reading. Yeah, I think if we just hold on to the love, it's there. It's waiting behind this. But we can go either way, right? We can make the rush decision and then maybe never get to uncover this. Or, you know, chill out, let this energy fall away on its own naturally. And then there this is. Now under this, I'm sure this isn't a mistake either, is the moon. Okay, how much sense does this make? To me, total. This is a reading. I already did the reading of the new moon, but now this is a reading of the black moon, specifically that aspect of the new moon. Archangel Haniel, important psychic events behind the scenes, right, that we don't get to see. We have to have faith instead that they're actually happening. Again, release fears that hold you back. So two cards about major fear and maybe manipulation and being enticed by different things. But under that is the Emperor, Archangel Michael, whose feast day it is today, the day on which I'm doing this reading. I don't think any of this is a mistake. Followed by the Four of Air, rest and recovery. So we could easily do this instead of, you know, harassing one another. Underneath that is the Two of Water. So this is coming. A relationship that continues to grow closer. Forgiveness. This is also the season of forgiveness still. We can't forget that. Like the whole next couple months between the Jubilee year and going directly from that into Rosh Hashanah and directly from that into Yom Kippur. And it's just a season of forgiveness and the positive resolution of a conflict. And the Knight of Water. Your wish comes true. Concerns fade away. A love of life. And the Knight of Water, emotional, romantic, enthusiastic, contemplative, falling in love, or wedding proposals, the need to balance emotions, an invitation to a social event. So maybe some of us just want to stay home this weekend and to ourselves, maybe do that Four of Air so we don't trip. The feminine is the Empress, Archangel Gabriel, lavish abundance. Give birth to your dreams, nurture yourself and others. So far, two major arcana cards diagonal. Look at this. The Knight of Earth opposite the Ace of Earth. The inflow of abundance. Yeah, just keep your mind on work right now, maybe. A promising business venture. Important documents or contracts. Feminine subconscious. The Eight of Air. An illusion of being trapped. A lack of self-confidence. Afraid to take action. Well, that makes sense for those of us that do have a decision that has to be made separate and apart from Lilith and her black moon. This would be sort of avoidance of that. And I find it interesting that this false sense of being trapped is opposite this false sense of being trapped, although this one weighs heavier because it's major arcana. This is just a minor. Meaning, ladies, feminine, that this one is easier to, you know, like sort of chuck. We don't have to fall prey to this. Crowning is more earth, the king of earth, who is generous, professional, responsible, and practical. A successful time. Confidently accept opportunities you're afforded. The Midas touch. And Virgo is involved in all of this too. I don't remember how now at the moment. But I read something actually this afternoon that explained the Virgo part. Oh, I think it was my own horoscope, which I hadn't read in maybe a year, I mean, forever. I had not looked at my horoscope. And today it popped up in my email and I said, oh, and I clicked on it and it was something about Virgo being in, maybe Virgo was in the moon too. I don't remember. Don't stop me lying. In any case, shared at our feet, subconscious, more intuition. The High Priestess, Archangel Haniel. Listen to your intuition. Have patience. Consider carefully what you want before acting. So before you say, I'm done with this, I'm dumping him, I'm dumping her, I can't take it, listen to you and be still for a moment. Be still. Okay, leave them alone. Be still by yourself, to yourself. And then listen to your intuition. Just pause and listen. What is it saying? Am I going to feel the same way tomorrow? Tomorrow, am I going to not want to talk to her? Tomorrow, am I going to not want to talk to him? Am I not going to love her? Am I not going to love him? If the answer is yes, if you're really done, then be done. Be done if you think you can. Sometimes I think it helps to try to be done because at least it redirects you. We can't be done. Okay, there is no breakup. If you're a real twin, there is no breakup. There is no separation. We're always together, always in union. That's it. But I think it does help in some cases for people to at least try to separate themselves because it refocuses you on yourself and your healing. And then you may notice that as soon as you begin healing, here they come back. Why? Because the energy is better. Your energy is funky. The union is funky. We get what we give. What we put out is what we get back. We reap what we sow. We put out funk, we get back funk. Okay, in the center from Archangel Michael, the Five of Water. Things not turning out the way you'd hoped. Not seeing the positive of a situation. Not seeing these two cups that are upright. Crying over spilled milk. Here it is. So that's what we've been talking about, you know, this whole time. Being upset about the behavior. And I'm not saying that that's not justified. You know, I'm just saying, think about it in the scope of things, right? Consider the context. Look at it again a different way. I'm getting my romance cards and right away, love yourself first. And that's basically what this is about. And the need to perhaps fall back. Your self-respect makes you more romantically attractive. Ah, now just open to separation. Time apart from your partner is on the horizon. You might need to take it right now. Pay attention to the red flags. They're not acting like they normally do. You know, you see them falling into a slump. You feel yourself falling into a slump, you know, as a result or, you know, in tandem or whatever the case is. Pay attention to the red flags and say, you know what, we need to separate for a little while. Let me go over here and you go over there, please. I've opened to new love, and this is what comes to us after this energy moves away. It's a temporary energy. You don't want to base, you know, your whole life on what the moon is doing right now. Past life relationship. You have known each other before. Religious factors. Your love life is influenced by your religious upbringing and spiritual path. And a reader friend of mine the other day said to me that this is, for her at least, like the twin flame card of this deck, because it's about the spiritually based relationship. I can totally see it. Okay, that's the overall energy. atop the seven of fire, and this need to defend his beliefs and where he stands is calling in your soulmate. Your prayers, affirmations, and visualizations help bring you together. Atop the Knight of Earth, who is loyal, dedicated, honorable, and kind, and trotting along at a very paced manner, is romantic feelings. Your feelings are real and worth exploring. So here he comes. Clap, 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 clap this way. Atop ego and this false sense of entrapment and not knowing, you know, what to do, is it is safe for you to love. Open your heart to give and receive the highest energy of all. Atop the Empress and Archangel Gabriel, lavish abundance and giving birth to our dreams is healing family issues. Your love life benefits as you forgive your parents and giving birth together. This may have to do with healing issues in the family, like before you grow the family anymore. You know what I mean? Top the Ace of Earth is finances and career. Makes a lot of sense to me. Financial issues are a factor in your love life right now. Yeah, the issue of getting paper, because you're the Ace of Earth. That's not a problem here in this reading. Not at all. It's here opposite the Knight of Earth too. So we got from both sides. Cash rules everything around me. Cream, get the money. Okay, and the feminine subconscious is reconciliation. So yes, just fall back a little bit. You know, and you know, there is no breakup. There is no need for the reconciliation. But if you want to call it separation, reconciliation, because it sounds, makes sense that way, fine. Someone from your past is returning to your love life. So no need to be panicky and worried. We're still connected. We're always worry. Atop the King of Earth. Oh, I forgot we had more Earth there. For real, everything is around us. Now this is interesting and not very clear to me yet. This is where pay attention to the red flags decided to show up. The signs are cautioning you. I wonder if there is somebody at work. If there is someone at work who has the Lilith, who's trying to distract some of the masculines here. Maybe. Because this is not a mistake, that the King of Earth is diagonal to the Ace of Earth and finances and career. Why is pay attention to the red flags there? I mean, I can also understand why it would be pay attention to the red flags in relation to calling in the soulmate or in relation to the soulmate in a relationship period. Yes, pay attention to the red flags, but I'm just curious as to why it's paired with the King of Earth. And the first thing that came to me was something for some going on at work. Maybe there's, you know, someone trying to get in between there. Atop the High Priestess and having patience and not rushing to judgment is wedding. So maybe fall back, chill out, and wait, because this situation involves marriage. And the heart of the matter atop the Five of Water, what spirit does not want you to miss and allow to just, you know, to be, pay attention to this, because this could be the one. You've already met the romantic partner you seek. Okay, advice, guys. Career change. Maybe you got to get away from somebody funky at the job. Career change. Time to decide. Same thing with the Two of Air. Make a decision based on your heart's true desires. Open just now to practice. Time to decide is back. And just open to justice. Your career brings fairness and protection to others who need your help. But I think what was staring out at me was justice and time to decide. It's about doing the right thing again. time to decide is back. Study, reading, research, and education help you gain confidence and clarity about your career. These are my life purpose cards, if you're wondering why so much about the career. But I just felt to pick them up, so I guess I was meant to. You're on the right path. Keep doing what you're doing because it's working. That's the overall energy. And one from here. I'm going to do. I just opened to transmutation and healing sounds. I did sort of prescribe healing sounds to a couple of the women that I spoke to. Just open to Mother Mary and sorrow. I can understand why that would be the case. Sometimes I wonder why she would be sad, but I understand right now. I just open to sacred union. Mother Mary, of course, being the opposite of Lilith. Mother Mary being the queen of all angels, Lilith being a fallen, expelled angel. Now opening to the universal heart right behind his mother, the divine quintessential masculine of all time, the healer of all time, divine healer. Here to heal this situation. And landing on answered prayer. And at the bottom of the deck is the guardian, here to remind us that we all have guardian angels protecting us, surrounding us at all times. And today, particularly, we're celebrating all those angels and thanking them for their divine protection. We'll take this one first. Masculine, your advice is light and love. Your purpose is to bring divine healing, light, and love to this world. So do what you need to do to avoid that darkness that's trying to get to you. Feminine, your advice is oracle cards. You are able to discern answers and guidance for yourself and others. Perhaps just by even paying attention to a reading. Or if you have cards and you can pull them for yourself, maybe you should be doing that too. Looking closely, more closely to your own situation. I won't go over again now how I feel in general about oracle cards. And further to that, masculine, your advice is message from afar. And feminine, yours is transience. So let's see what those are about. Message from afar. Have the courage to live your dream. Let all unfold from within your soul. Listen to your inner voice. Be yourself. Do what your heart asks of you. That's the second message that says, listen to your heart, follow your heart, that I've read. Live, speak, and breathe your truth. So that seven of wands is under there is exactly what you're doing there. Every situation you find yourself in is here to help you grow in love and wisdom. Always make the most of life. Focus on what you have, not on what you don't. Be grateful. Show compassion for those less fortunate than you. Smile more often. Dance when no one is watching. Think about your eternal soul. Think about eternity. Think about heaven. Remember to smell the roses, to look up at the sky, to feel the earth beneath you and the endless universe that surrounds you and the stars above you. Feel the breeze, the trees, and the love that fills and surrounds you. You are loved unconditionally, no matter what. Think about 1,000 years from now and 1,000,000 years from now. So this is going to the, you know, the everlasting life that is coming. If you're patient, for those that are patient and hopeful and faithful and dedicated and committed. Transience, feminine. It is possible to transcend a current difficulty by shifting your awareness and focus. Exactly what I was just saying. Shift it away from the masculine and romance, if you need to, if this applies to you, and on to yourself. Love yourself first. That was somewhere. I don't know where it is now, but do it. Love can help you rise above all obstacles. It will help you to see things from a higher perspective, and your problems will seem much smaller. Sit quietly in meditation. Imagine streams of crystal-colored light flowing down upon you, and feel this light pouring into each of the 7 energy centers in your body. Number 1, root, base of spine, red. Number 2, sacral, below the navel, orange. Number 3, solar plexus, above the navel, yellow. Number 4, heart, center of chest, green and pink. Number 5, throat, light blue. Number 6, third eye, forehead, indigo. And number 7, crown, top of the head, violet and white light. I hope that you guys enjoyed this daily reading. Namaste, angels.